The carving tools we're going to be working with today is similar to this. This is a flex cut, which has a different handle, but the blade is about the same. When I bought this set, it came from Wayne Barton, and it comes as a pair. This is a stab knife, and it's not used very much. I'll show you how that, what it's done. It just makes indentions in it. Okay, this is other stuff that you're going to need. You're going to need a leather strap, flexible rulers. This is what you need to draw patterns on it, on this right here. And this to draw circles to do your rosettes. This is your ceramic stone to sharpen the knife. Pencils, if you design this pattern right on the board with a pencil, you use a soft lead because the pencil will dent the wood, and then you have to sand it off again and start over again. So it's just stuff like that that you learn along the way. If you're going to trace the pattern onto the wood using a carbon paper or something like that, don't use carbon paper. Use graphite paper. And carbon paper will soak into the wood, and you might as well toss it. But the graph paper is just like pencil lead. But that's still a hard thing to look at, because you got to draw a pattern somewhere or another to trace. And you'll see some patterns that you probably wouldn't want to try. The knife is a scary sharp. And it's sharp because when you make the cuts, it's polished. Each side of the chip is polished. You don't have to go down in there do any cleaning up. If you do it right, the angle that you're going to be holding out, this angle from here up to here is 65 degrees. Now you can make it plus or minus a couple degrees if you want to. But it's used on every cut. And now the stab knife, is that good with you? Yeah, it's good. See these little things right there? That's all the stab knife is good for, is that. But it helps a little bit. And this is all done with a knife, the scroll. Sharpening. Okay, this is one of the toughest part of chip carving. It has to be extremely sharp. When I did this one here, I was using ceramic stone, and it's a black coarse and a white honing stone. This honing stone is probably like 6 pounds of grit, and the ceramic stone, I'm guessing, is about 800. But we use this one here to the black stone to set the initial taper of the blade to 10 degrees. And I'll show you how to do that. I haven't looked at much, but I think there's probably a lot of new things other than ceramics that you can sharpen your blades with now. Ceramic stones are expensive. Back when I bought these, they were about $40 a piece, something like that. I think there's diamond stones that would be just as good these days. Okay, here's the white, and that's the black. You set the taper here and hone it here. But if you want to get 10 degrees, put the dime under the back edge of the knife, and that sets your 10 degrees. Now, you don't need to put the dime on every time, but you ought to get a feel for that, so that you just, with your right hand, turn it up and press down on the blade to keep it on the stone, and it goes back and forth. And you ought to keep the blade straight across like that. But you get the feel of that pretty fast. These are a whole bunch of knives that you can. Now, this knife on this end and this knife on this end is a pair. The other knives in here, this knife here is the same as this, but the back's cut off of it. So I recommend, as a starter, this knife here only. And even though it's the same as this, but it's easier to judge the angle with this wide blade that way. This still cuts good, but you ought to start with this. These are in here for small letter. You don't get down to real small. But you can still do lettering with this, but sometimes it gets kind of deep, such the detail, you might need these right here. Okay, here's the one of the main things we've got to do. You got to be able to hold the knife. And notice my wrist is straight, and that's the way it needs to be done. And the knife is embedded into your hand, so just so that the blade by itself is sticking out. This thumb is always thrown out in this contact with the wood. We'll be holding the blades just like this and carving them. And the reason to do that is you've got to turn the wood under the knife. We'll get into a lot more detail on that. Okay, the wood, basswood is the most popular, but butternut can be used too. It's darker, but it carves just like basswood. Poplar and white northern pine are other two, and I've tried cutting just to make sure, and it does work. But I don't want to have 300 hours carving on it here that's going to look like pine. So I don't want to fool with it. Okay. Basswood does not stain well. If you try to do it, it's very splotchy. So I don't even use any stain on any of those over there. And it's just spray on polyurethane. But I do put 6 to 8 coats on everything. Real thin coats. Let it dry. Put on a coat. Let it dry overnight. And put on another coat, then sand it a little bit, spray it another coat. So it takes about a week to get a finish on. I used steel wool back then, and I still ought to change that because I found out some of the steel wood particles got down into the incisions and rusted. So just use a 220 sandpaper real light. We'll take care of that. Now, once you've got all these coats of paint on it, you can enhance it a little bit more by taking something like a stain that I call a golden oak. It's probably other colors, and just flush it. The top, fill all the chips, and then wipe it off as soon as you can. It's just enough staves in there to give it a patina effect. I don't believe either one, I'm not sure any of those have that on it right now. Okay. But that does happen. And these are the boards that we'll be going working to learn to use a knife. This is a pattern board, and this is one that's already finished. This side is curved chips. This side is straight line. We'll probably get about half of it done today. And you're over here, you can get different patterns. You can carve this right here 4 or 5 ways. This is a 20-point rosette. If you count these around there, it's 20. And then it goes out quite more. It's combined 2 and 3 cut chips. This is a particular in the middle. You notice you have scroll work around all this. Now, when you have something like this right here, you've got drawers stacked together. To carve this right here, you have to take the top drawer and this drawer and C-clamp them together and carve this scroll around it. Matter of fact, even down here, you have to clamp it together. Once you get these two carved, and you throw this one away and go back and go to this one, get these two. So that's the scheme to it. But you have to cut across these, your seam. More patterns. Now, patterns is going to be one of your biggest problems. You can find them on the internet, but generally everything you find on the internet is not exactly what you want, so you got to either modify it or somewhere made it. So the best thing you do is get your CAD system, like an AutoCAD or others. I don't know what's the one that we use around here. I don't know if that's good enough or not. I haven't tried that. But I use AutoCAD to draw the patterns. You kind of have to watch. These are a little bit larger, but I think you do it. But most of the people, I just tell them to make 1/4-inch chips. And I think that's it. You don't want to over-carve. Wayne Barton told me this, and I kind of believe in it. He says some amount of uncarved space will enhance your pattern. Once you got a pattern, you've got to set up a carving sequence. The only way I found to do it is put a dot on each chip that you want to take out. And we'll see that in just a moment. The pattern graph paper, this is where I want to talk about. Use graph paper, not carbon paper, to trace a pattern. And lead and You definitely, it's just, we're faced with that. So get a pattern without, learning the pattern without tracing is what we're going to do. The pattern on the next slide is an ellipse that is about 10 inches by 7 inches. And I'm going to show you that next. That's a pattern that you have to draw. And this is, every chip that has a pattern, it has a dot on it. And I do put the dot on with a computer. But this, how would you like to trace that entire thing? You don't want to do it. After you do that for a while, you just, most people I think just give up on it and do something else. But if you do it right, and you can put this pattern on in less than a minute. And that's what we're going to talk about more. That's your bold piece. That's the piece that was just here. Okay, pattern transfer to the wood. Here, however you draw your patterns, once you're finished with them, I'll do it all on the computer. I'll print the pattern out the exact size I want, and take that copy and go to Staples or someplace that has copy machines. And I guess they use a toner, is that what it is?
Yeah, toner. Yeah.
And you make a toner copy. And we're going to use that to, and when you use, what you want to do is get that toner copy. And you probably want to give it just the darkness up a little bit. It varies in color and this particular one here was made about a year ago, and I have some copies. It works fine, but I think that recently the new machine is not as liberal with their toner as it used to be, and some of these are a little bit lighter because of that. But all you got to do now is all we have to do now is get you a small pad and take that small pad, dampen it with lacquer thinner, and rub the back of that paper vigorously. And you hold it so it don't slip, or if you slip, it'll smear. And the paper will become transparent, so you can see where it's working or not. Now, I want our, just take a small cloth. Got it that on it. You see the paper's transparent. What you ought to do is if you want to do this, is practice on from scrap wood, because if you get it too wet, it'll smear, and if you don't get it wet enough, the copy don't come out that well. Now, let's see what we got. Now, you see, I haven't rubbed it enough, so we have to go back and... Should be all right. That's pretty good. It's one use. Thank you. One use. But that's good enough to carve from. Remember the dime thing. Now this is one. I don't use this knife because it's thick. Yeah. And put it on something else. Yeah. Knife, this hand, hold it flat. Reach out, tilt it up at 10 degrees, and you work it. You may spend an hour doing this. Turn it around. Now you can do that on water stones or diamond stone. But these are the stones. Now these are probably 10 years old. They don't wear out. The only thing can happen to them if you drop them, they're subject to breaking. Now, I think people, some of you talk about patterns, detail and patterns. Pass that around, you can see the left work that goes into patterns. Some of them is pretty complex. That pattern right there is that four circuit thing. Okay. I think we covered all this right here. Here's an example. I didn't bring this piece in, but I put the patterns on this entire thing in less than 10 minutes. The whole thing had the patterns on it. And I tell you, do it any other way. I really don't know how you would do it any other way. And these are the boards that we're working with. One of the first things we're going to do is we're going to learn to set the angle. Okay. And, this board has a spot here that when you push the knife in, you have to measure the angle. And you've got to get as close to 65 degrees as you possibly can. This is a stack of boards that I got back from Wayne Barton that I completed before I even tried a project. Maybe about 15, maybe 30 boards. And but it's just like any other. You got to practice. Pretty much 6 months before I was really happy with the thing, the way it turned out. This is just show you some of the things that happened. When you're carving, you should not stop anywhere along the edges there. When you stop, you're going to leave something like that right there. Uh, and cutting out pre-cut chips. The chips should be very carefully cut at the edges of the, at the tips of it. And if you're not, if you have to be careful because of the, if your depth is not right, you're going to end up breaking off that. As an example, this is the grain that's going this way now. Now, if you overcut here, you're going to undercut that tip, and it's going to fall off. It's got to be just like that. So your knife, as you go through the wood, is really an arc. It's an arc. You start off shallow, deep in the middle, and it's cut out. And other little things that you'll get as you go along, you'll get these things corrected there. And this is all magnified, so it's easy to see it here. When you make a chip, leave the bottom of that chip breaks off, and it's quite common. Don't dig it out, cut it out. It, just repeat those three cuts, and it'll fall out. Okay. This is one of a pattern where the center wasn't protected. You overcut just a little bit there, and then you kind of mess up this other side. So cut right to the spot, let's see. You can't see it too well, but some of these chips right here have a flat surface. That top cut is supposed to be sharp. So what you need to do is, when you make the carving, split the line in half. And cut it off. That's going to be hard to do. But you then need to learn to do that. And when you make the first cut, you can still see where you need to make the second cut, I'm going to show something. Ideally, that should be very sharp, and this would be this is a piece of wood, and this is we cut out, and this be cut out. What you really need to do is go right to the line. Cut the line and then come over here and go that way. And then what happens is this is the surface of your wood, and this tip is lower than the top of wood. Second cut makes it lower. Makes it top crest below the level of the board. When you sand it a little bit, you're going to sand it and take it, and you're going to sand down that sharp. Probably that was a disaster right there. Grain is going to be an issue. Cut with the grain is fine. Cutting cross grain is tough, and you'll see that. Okay, folks. Already?
Thank you. Thank you.